we want to have a sense of direct light, some really strong aspects within this painting, but also we want to have a lot of subtlety and some quiet areas as well. So holding back with that tone and not blowing out the entire dynamic from the outset, it's going to be really important. I've not only been holding out with that tone, but also my color and saturation. I hold back with greens. Greens are a really dangerous color when it comes to painting a landscape. If we get too much yellow out in that green and it's too strong, it comes too far forward. So what I do is desaturate this, gray it out, and push it way back. Conversely, as those tiers of depth come forward, the green gets stronger and stronger and stronger. And it's by playing with these tonal relationships as well as these color relationships that allows me to create a sense of depth in the scene. Adding some details here in the foreground, I'm going to get a bit more intense with my tones and my colors. That green is so much stronger, but also the tone in this tree is so much darker, so it's going to start to leap ahead of that distant mountain. This painting is all about the crispy details. Some of my favorite stuff to paint are things like this log here in the foreground. This just really sets the mood and the stage for the painting. It's just little areas like this, little pops of detail that form these visual treats for the viewer with just a touch of impasto medium. This is the last step of painting water where I worry about any of those individual surface details like the sparkle and the meniscus as a solid object enters the body of water. My favorite marks are those last little bits of light coming out of the sky. And I decide the painting's finished when I can't think of another brushstroke to add.
Painters have it a little easier. Not in the beginning, but after they master all this art of theirs, they can create the things that photographers can only capture if they're lucky or patient enough. The painter can sit on a winter morning in his pyjamas, do something like that, doesn't even exist in real life. The photographer has to go over there, strap everything on his back, and pray that everything goes in his favor. Now, there are many approaches to create this in photography, and I would say that some will attempt what I described in the previous video, the focus stepping process, by having either the camera or doing it manually, focusing here, then here, then here, then here, and stacking up the images. With a wide angle lens, this will take about 5-6 images, but that will create a very crisp background, very sharp and crisp background, which does not correspond to human vision, the way we see a scene like that. And it kind of deprives it of its awe and majesty and depth. Some other people would say, I'm gonna just focus here, close it down to f11, and even better, let's say focus here and then close down to f8, f9, f11, f13, whatever, take 5 or 6 shots and choose the best. Because focus stacking the images, will have the negative effect of blurring out the water, which is moving here. So that's why I say sometimes we don't need to aim for a visual effect of sharpness throughout the image. It's just, you know, we need to ask ourselves, what am I seeing clearly here with my own eyes? Can I clearly see this part if we imagine we're there? Can we clearly see this part with our own eyes? No. Well, then it becomes a non-issue in terms of making the entire image sharp, right? What can I see clearly with my own eyes? Oh, I can see up to here, you say, while you observe the scene. So that's what I will aim for. And you take 5 or 6 shots and then you choose the best, aiming for mainly this area and leaving the rest not completely blurry, like a bokeh or something, but having this effect, not trying to penetrate the fog. Because more and more amateur photographers realize now what they hadn't realized 3 years ago, that professionals who would photograph something like that, they take a lot of shots. They take a lot of shots, and sometimes it doesn't work the light was not good, and they go the next day to try the same thing. And sometimes they will stay in the general area for a week or so, going up and down, and you know, because the problem with photography is that all the elements have to conspire together to come and create something that is to your pleasure or is impressive enough in the case of landscapes.
Now, I've been putting off the barn until now. It's sitting out here in the middle of open space like a bit of an anomaly. Its colors don't match the background or the foreground at all. So now I want to just try and redefine some of those edges that I may have lost, and then think a little bit about how I'm going to paint this texture of the structure. One of the first things, though, that I need to consider is the light that's going to be hitting this barn. In order to have any kind of light dynamic at all, we've got to focus really closely on the shadows. Shadows really communicate just as much light as highlights do.
So go ahead and watch a few painters' videos where they explain what they're doing. It's going to help you see your item, the subject item, in a different way, and it will also help you process the image better in order to show all these things. Thanks a lot. Bye.